remember, and they're counting down. And then as soon as it lifts off, you can feel it in your chest. My mom is not on the planet. She's really gone.
We all start wondering if we're doing the right thing. Should I have been on this mission? Should I have left my family back there? And that can lead to devastating psychological effects.
In the next decade, the U.S. will send astronauts to Mars for the first time. The journey will be one of extreme isolation, since crew members will be unable to communicate with the ground crew in real time.
A new documentary follows a NASA psychologist tasked with preparing the astronauts for this monumental three-year journey. It's called Space, The Longest Goodbye, and the film's director, Ido Mizrahi, joins us now. Good morning.
Hi, good morning.
Maybe astronauts haven't been in space for 3 years, but I would imagine any trip to space can be isolating and difficult. What is different about this in the way that you approach it?
You mean what's different about a three-year journey as opposed to a shorter one?
Yeah, I mean, even if you're away from your family for 8 months or a year in space, I would imagine that's psychologically difficult too. Is there anything new that you had to bring to the table for this?
It is new. I mean, I think, you know, when you think about 3 years, that's a big chunk of your life. You know, I think the way astronauts and NASA are approaching it is you're starting this kind of new life with a new family on this spacecraft, and then on Mars, and then on your way back, right? So you sort of have to build as much of a comfortable environment as you can, because this is going to be your new home for the next few years.
It's psychologically interesting to think about who volunteers for something like this, because it's one thing to be an astronaut, you know, it's a shorter mission, but I mean, I'm surprised that the amount of moms and people with kids or dads with kids would volunteer for this.
You know, it's interesting. For my first instinct was, of course, you probably want to send single people with no families.
Right.
That'll be the easiest. But, you know, are you actually, as an astronaut, making the best decisions if you don't have a family or loved ones to come back to? And that's a really interesting idea, right? Since these are not test pilots who are just going for like a few days and coming back. It's a marathon. They're going to be making a lot of really important, potentially critical decisions, right? If there's someone to come back to that's always on your mind, maybe you're making more weighted and smarter decisions.
As this process has gone along, have any of these people dropped out thinking, I can't do this? Like, you do these psychological tests and they realize I can't.
You know, it's interesting. And for folks who want to watch the documentary, and I hope many will, some of the simulations didn't last as long as they thought they would. These are not necessarily astronauts, they're kind of like mock astronauts, but they found that, you know, some of them that were supposed to last almost a year couldn't necessarily last a few days. I think the astronauts themselves are pretty well recruited. I mean, these are people who are really aware of all their frailties and all the difficulties that they're going to encounter, and they're ready for it, you know?
And so I hope this isn't too obvious, but is it the concern that they will have a mental breakdown and will not be able to fulfill their mission, or is there more to it than that?
I think we know about the physical challenges, right? So radiation probably being the biggest one. The mental one is really on NASA's, at the top of NASA's list. I mean, it's in the sort of top five hazards that they're looking at, is both the isolation from loved ones and ground, and then also the dynamic between the crew members, right? How do you build a kind of like a band that really complements each other?
Yeah. It's interesting to think, is the time frame on this truly less than 10 years? We are going to see people doing this mission.
It got pushed back a little. I mean, I think when we started working on this, thinking about this was a few years back, they kept talking about, this also has to do with the best launch windows between Earth and Mars. They were talking about 2033. I think if we can land on the moon in 2 years, we can look at crewed missions in the 2030s, but I don't know that they have an exact year yet, but they're headed there. I mean, look, the Artemis program is moving really nicely, and we're about to come back to the moon, and that's going to be a big step before Mars.
Is anyone working on the technology that maybe you could somehow communicate with Earth, or use virtual reality or something to help you, or robots or AI to help you cope if that became an issue?
Totally. I mean, both robots and AI companions are in the works, and you'll see that in the documentary, and it has interesting mixed results. And certainly virtual environments for astronauts and their families to spend time in. What's interesting is that it's not going to be real time, right? So you'll kind of show up to your virtual environment, and then your spouse will show up hours later and just kind of see what you did there, and then maybe complement that by doing something else. So it's kind of like a game of chess. You're never really there at the same time.
Well, it's fascinating. It's Space, The Longest Goodbye. It's streaming now, and you can follow on social media for more. Thanks so much for being with us.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me. This is fun.